11 years old.
Hi, my name is Cal Summer, and I'm 14 years old.
Hi, my name is Hannah Calentine, and I'm 14 years old.
Hi, my name is Ava Davis, and I'm 13 years old.
Hi, my name is Weston Myers, and I'm 13 years old.
Hello, my name is Ethan Westgrave, and I'm 12 years old.
Hi, my name is Kara Risky, and I'm 14 years old.
And we will be reciting from the account of the martyrdom of Perpetua and Philiketos.
On the day before, when they had their last meal, which was called the free banquet, they celebrated not a banquet, but rather a love feast. They spoke to the mob with the same steadfastness, warned them of God's judgment, stressing the joy that would come in their suffering, ridiculing the curiosity of those that came to see him. Satyrus said, "Will tomorrow not be enough for you? Why are you so eager to see something you dislike? Your friends today will be your enemies on tomorrow. But take careful note of what they look like, so you recognize them on the day." Thus, everyone would depart from the prison in amazement, and many began to believe.
The day of their victory dawned, and they marched from the prison to the amphitheater, joyfully, as though they were going to heaven, with calm faces, trembling, if at all, with joy rather than fear. Perpetua went along with shining countenance and calm step, as the beloved of God, as a wife of Christ, putting down everyone's intense stare with her own intense gaze. With them was Philiketos, glad that she had safely given birth so that now she could fight the beast, going from one bloodbath to another, from the midwife to the gladiator, ready to wash after childbirth and a second baptism.
Their event led up to the gates where the men were forced to put on the robes of the priestess of Saturn. The women, the dress of the priestess of Ceres. But noble Perpetua strenuously resisted this till the end. "We came to this of our own free will, that our freedom should not be violated. We pledged our lives to this, provided that we would do no such thing. You agreed with us to do this. Even injustice recognized justice. The military tribune agreed. Each they were to be sent into the arena just as they were." Perpetua then began to sing a song. She was already treading on the head of the Egyptians. Provocatus, Saturninus, and Satyrus began to warn the onlooking mob. And then, when they came into sight of Phlerianus, they said by the motions and gestures, "You have condemned us, but God will condemn you," was what they were saying. At this, the crowd became enraged and demanded that they be scourged before a line of gladiators, and they rejoiced in this, that they had obtained to share in the Lord's sufferings.
But he who said, "Ask, and you shall receive," answered their prayer by giving each one the death he had asked for. For whenever they would discuss among themselves their desire for martyrdom, Saturninus indeed insisted that he wanted to be exposed to all the different beasts, that his crown might be all more glorious. And so, at the outset of the contest, he and Revocatus were matched with a leopard, and then, while in the stocks, they were attacked by a bear. As for Satyrus, he dreaded nothing more than a bear, and counted on being killed by one bite of a leopard. Then he was matched with a wild boar. But the gladiator who had tied him to the animal was gored and died a few days after the contest, whereas Satyrus was only dragged along. Then he was matched with a bear. But the animal refused to come out of the cages, so that Satyrus was called back once more unhurt.
For the young woman, however, the devil had prepared a mad heifer. This was an unusual animal. However, it was chosen that their sex might be matched with that of the beast. So they were stripped, placed in nets, and thus brought out into the arena. Even the crowd was horrified when they saw that one was a delicate young girl and the other a woman fresh from childbirth. So they were pulled back again and given unmelted tunics to wear.
First the heifer tossed Perpetua, and she fell on her back. Then, sitting up, she pulled down the tunic that had been ripped along the side so that it covered her thighs, thinking more of her modesty than of her pain. Then she asked for a pin to fasten her untidy hair. For it was not right that a martyr should die with her hair in disorder, lest she might seem to be mourning in her hour of trying. Then she got up, seeing that Philippiatos had been crushed to the ground. She went over to her, gave her hand, and lifted her up. Then the two stood side by side, but the cruelty of the mob was by now appeased, so they were called back through the gate of life.
There, Perpetua was held up by a man named Rusticus, who was at the time a catechumen and kept close to her. Then she awoke from a kind of sleep, so absorbed had she been in a kind of ecstasy of the spirit. She began to look about her. Then, to the amazement of all, she said, "When are we going to be thrown to that heifer or whatever it is?"
When told that this had already happened, she refused to believe it, until she saw the marks of her rough experience on her person and her dress. Then she called for her brother and spoke to him together with the catechumens and said, "You must all stand fast in the faith and love one another, and do not be weakened by what we have gone through." At another gate, Saturnus was earnestly addressing the soldier Pudens. "It is exactly," he said, "as I have foretold and predicted. So far, not one animal has touched me. So now you may believe me with all your heart. I am going in there and I shall be finished off with one bite of the leather."
And immediately, as the contest was coming to a close, a leopard was let loose, and after one bite, Satyrus was so drenched with blood that as he came away, the mob roared in witness to his second baptism, saying, well washed, for well washed indeed was one who had been bathed in such a manner."
Then he said to the soldier Pudens, "Goodbye, remember me and remember the faith. These things should not disturb you, but rather strengthen you." And with this, he asked Pudens for a ring from his finger, and dipping it into his wound, he gave it back to him as a pledge and as a record of his bloodshed. Shortly after, he was thrown unconscious with the rest in the usual spot to have his throat cut. But the mob asked that their bodies be brought into the open, so that their eyes might be the guilty witnesses of the sword that pierced their flesh. And so the martyrs went to the place of their own accord, and kissing one another, they sealed their martyrdom with the ritual kiss of peace. And so the others took the sword in silence, without moving, especially Satyrus, being the first to climb the stairway, was the first to die. For once again, he was waiting for Perpetua. However, he had yet to taste more pain. She screamed as she was struck on the bum. Then she took the hand of the young gladiator and guided it to her throat. It was as though so great a woman, feared as she was by the unclean spirit, could not be dispatched unless she herself were willing.
"Ah, most valiant and blessed martyrs, truly are you called and chosen for the glory of Christ Jesus our Lord. And any man who exalts, honors, and worships his glory should read for the consolation of the church these new deeds of heroism, which are no less significant than the tales of old. And these new manifestations will bear witness to one and the same Spirit, who still operates, and to God the Father Almighty, to his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom is splendor and immeasurable power for all the ages. Amen.